Welcome to Positive Atheism English channel. From the book The Life and Times of Gaura, written by Mark Rindley, we are learning about the five eminent friends of Gaura's. In the last episode, we have learned about Nehru. Today, we shall know about Vinoba Bhave. Vinoba Bhave was a very devout, sweet and thin Gandhian philosopher, theologian, whom many in India regarded as Gandhi's spiritual heir, although Gandhi himself avoided such a designation. Vinoba joined Gandhi's ashram in northwest India in 1916 and 5 years later moved to a town in central India, Wardha, where he founded a branch of the ashram in response to a request by a rich devotee who had given much of his wealth to support Gandhian projects. In 1938, Vinoba started a rural ashram of his own near Wardha. Gandhi, in a well-known article of 1940, described how Vinoba had devoted the largest part of his time to spinning, had helped develop a scheme of education through handicrafts, had taken part in every menial activity of the ashram from scavenging, cleaning up refuse to cooking, had abolished every trace of untouchability from his heart, had dedicated himself to the service of lepers and attracted disciples and workers who would rise to any sacrifice at his bidding, and how Vinoba believed that constructive work is far more effective than the already heavily crowded political platform. 3 years after Gandhi's assassination in 1948, Vinoba became a public leader. During the Telangana Liberation Movement of 1947-48 for liberation from rule by the Nizam of Hyderabad, the communist cadres ordered arms when they then used in 1949-51 in a militant land reform movement by which they had hoped to make that part of India serve the role that human had served in the Chinese Communist Revolution. Nehru sent in the army to protect the landowners and their property. Vinoba decided to tour the area. This was in April 1951 and preach non-violence, somewhat as Gandhi had toured various parts of India to quell religious violence. As he approached one of the villages, however, his way was blocked by 80 untouchables who said they wouldn't let him pass if this intention were just to preach non-violence without doing something about the fact that they had no land. They wanted 1 acre each. He agreed to take up the issue, and at the meeting in the village, the largest local landowner offered to donate 100 acres to 100 landless peasants. That night, Vinoba reckoned that an equivalent rate of donations throughout India would come to some 50 million acres and decided to dedicate himself to that end. God appeared before me and we had a dialogue. I wanted to go to landlords and ask for more land, but I was hesitating when God intervened and said, "Keep faith in me and go. Ask for more land." Thus began Vinoba's Bhudan movement, that is land gift. Between then and 1964, he walked 65,000 kilometers from village to village in various parts of India, appealing for donations of land. In 1965-69, he focused on one of the poorest provinces, Bihar, and used a car to get about as he was now quite old. In all, he achieved the transfer of some 2.5 million acres of arable land to the ownership of hitherto landless peasants. Another 1.5 million acres proved to be non-arable or got tied up in a litigation. It was Vinoba who coined the proverb, "Think globally, act locally." In the mid-1950s, a fear arose that since he declared in 1954 that the centenary of the 1857 uprising against the British was to be the year when the Bhudan movement would achieve a land revolution, it might at that time venture beyond friendly requests into some kind of protesting against landlords who hadn't donated. These fears were conveyed to Nehru, who visited Vinoba in 1957 and persuaded him not to risk causing civil unrest. Vinoba remained for the rest of his life incongruous to landlords, and Gaura criticized him on this account while maintaining nonetheless a remarkably idealistic political philosophy of his own. When people get so far prepared as to offer their all to society, we will build up a government which will not need to seek help from America nor paper money from a government printing press. Every Indian home will be its bank. People will readily comply with whatever demand it may choose to make of them. People will leave all their worries to the care of the society and be themselves free from any anxiety or insecurity. Meanwhile, the Indian communists towards the end of 1951, as many people were investing more hope in Vinoba's program than in their armed struggle, had given up that struggle and had taken part as a political party in the first elections of independent India. But in 1961, a small group reverted to armed activities, interfering with elections, threatening to assassinate landlords, etc. And in 1962, a new and more militant party, the CPI-M, was founded to compete with the Communist Party of India. The CPI-M is today larger and more powerful than the CPI. These two and some of their leftist parties have often governed the two provinces of India, Kerala and West Bengal, where genuine land reform has been achieved, and in Kerala, universal primary schooling as well. Gora in the late 1940s had visited Vinoba now and then at his ashram, which is within walking distance from about 10 kilometers of Sevagram, and Gora and Lavana spent most of the 1955 to 58 working in the Bhutan movement. Vinoba's share of the work was to walk and to conduct prayer meetings, at the end of which he would ask the local landowners to donate a sixth of their holdings. All the administrative details were left to assistants. During the main tour of Andhra, which was in 1955, Lavanam translated Vinoba's talks from Hindi to Telugu, the language of Andhra, but declined because of his atheism to translate the prayers. In response to this, Vinoba, who was steeped in religious scriptures and was thus perfectly mindful that Jesus forbade praying in public, decided to forego all kinds of public prayer other than the silent contemplation of truth, non-violence, and active compassion. Gora and Lavanam saw less of Vinoba after he completed in 1958 the South Indian part of the Bhutan tour. Vinoba returned to his ashram in 1969. He did not approve of the JP movement, but he did conduct political fasts to secure enforcement of a national law prohibiting the slaughter of cows and to prevent the main North Indian language, Hindi, from being imposed as the link language in South India, where English is preferred for that purpose. In 1982, he decided that the time was ripe for him to die, and achieved it calmly and efficiently within a few days, during which Prime Minister of Indira Gandhi came from 1,000 miles away to kneel at his feet by abstaining from eating and drinking. Thank you. We shall meet in the next episode again.
Please download Samaram Multichannel app and watch your favorite channels from your mobile. App available on Google Play Store, and subscribe to the channels. For more videos, please subscribe to this channel, Positive Atheism, and activate the bell icon.